The following is an extra special extended episode of Suburban Underground. We hope you enjoy. The special number of today's episode is 30, and the special letter of today's episode is B, because Black Lives Matter. And frisk.
To my wife and kids.
Excuse me, ladies. Doing some shopping? I'm gonna have to stop and frisk you. I'm gonna open up the bag. What is this? Get your ass over here. Yeah. Stop and fucking frisk.
Thank you for running and throw you.
Hi, ladies. How you guys doing? I love that jacket. Okay. Very, very nice, ladies. So there was a bank robbery about 5 minutes ago, and the culprit looks exactly like you guys.
Oh, we don't know.
So I'm gonna have to stop and frisk you. Yeah, up against the wall.
Stop and frisk.
No, put your hands up. Put your motherfucking hands up now. Yo, what's good, my nigga? I fucked y'all up, right? Yeah. You need to visit your mom in jail. You best time out here. I'ma try though. I locked that bitch up though. Everybody, my name is DJ Stereotype. I am one of the hosts and I'm an executive producer of the television show Suburban Underground. Normally we like to keep things really fun and light and, you know, good time. But in lieu of a lot of the recent incidents that have been going on across the country, we wanted to have a bit more of a serious conversation. What's going on in Ferguson? What's going on here in New York with Stop and Frisk? And what's going on nationally with our armed forces seeming to attack our civilians is of grave concern to us. So today, we're going to be discussing more or less what's going on in this country right now. Are we being served and protected, or are we being hunted and attacked is the question. Bear with me, I have a bit of a speech, a little bit. I wanted to trace some major history so we can begin to have a conversation about the judicial and sort of police system, so just bear with me. And I am I'm going to talk about slavery, so deal with it. I wanted to say that African-American enslavement is dated back to begin the year 1619. So that's when African slaves were brought to North American colony of Jamestown, Virginia. And I also wanted to mention that December 18th, 1865, slavery was ended in the United States. So we're dealing with the time span of 1619 to 1865. So this means that the legal institution of slavery for black people in America lasted 246 years. If it is in fact true that it takes people twice as long to get over the pain of unhealthy relationships and trauma, that means it would take black people 492 years to flush the effects of slavery out of our system. In Willie Lynch's infamous letter and speech on how to break the spirit mentality and state of human beings, he wrote that these tactics that were used, if they were implemented correctly, would break the spirit of black men and women for at least 300 years. Slavery will have ended 149 years ago this December, which means that it lasted 97 years longer than we have been free. And it's not like things have been good and well since our people were emancipated. It has and still is a constant fight for our basic human rights. The average lifespan of an uninterrupted human life in America is approximately 81 years of age. 81 times 2 is 162, which means that we are not even two generations away from black people being enslaved. This means that if you're a black person born in this country, it's likely that your grandmother's mother and father were slaves. In turn, it means if you are a white American, your grandmothers and fathers may have been slave owners. Brown versus Board of Education was passed and handed down May 17th of 1954, legalizing integrated school systems in America. This was only 60 years ago, 21 years too young to have died according to the average lifespan of an American. This means we are not one generation away from racial segregation in schools. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 ended all state and local laws requiring segregation. My grandmother was my age, or maybe a few years younger, and my mother was in grade school. My mother remembers her and her siblings being called niggers, and white children who are now old enough to be my closest of white friends' parents refusing to sit next to them. I am not even 30 yet, but my mother, which means my peers' parents, walked through years of their lives going to separate bathrooms, drinking out of separate fountains, not able to dance together at concerts or sit in the same table or booth at a restaurant and eat together. Motown artists that we listen to this day, like Diana Ross and Smokey Robinson, were shot at during tours when they were in the South. So when we make the argument that racism was so long ago, that slavery was so long ago, that the pain and conflict of these things are invalid because people should just get over it and move on, let us be reminded that you cannot escape something that is existing and lingering directly in front of our faces that is not even old enough to have made the lifespan of an average American's life. People are tired of fighting and protesting, being arrested, and still to this day being murdered for standing up for basic, not even human, not even animal, not even plant, but the basic right to exist if you were born and granted life on this earth in whatever form you exist in. Homicide records show that at least 400 black men are killed annually by police officers. There is only 365 days to a year. That means that a black man is murdered by the police every 22 to 28 hours in America. This past month alone, 7 unarmed innocent black men not committing a crime of any sort at the times of their deaths have been gunned down by police officers. These are just the ones that grabbed major attention in the media. Eric Garner, Mike Brown, Dante Parker, Azelle Ford, John Crawford. Need I also mention Sean Bell, Oscar Grant, Frank Jude, Jonathan Carell, and countless others. The murdering of black men and boys is a real issue. But an even bigger issue is that those who are supposed to be serving and protecting us are the ones unrightfully incarcerating, harassing, abusing, and seem to be a direct reflection of our very own murder rates. So I invite you, all here in this studio, watching at home to join the cast and crew of Suburban Underground as we stand in solidarity. Black, white, and every other race, male and female, all sexual orientations, and a reflection of different generations by age as we ask the question, are we being served and protected or hunted and attacked? We want to know, how have race relations truly changed in America, and how does that affect all the citizens of the world? Thank you.
Rockin' sockin' boppers, it's Brooklyn Bandstand. Today, DJ Stereotype and the Bandstand crew say a little prayer for you.
Before I put on my makeup, I say a little
prayer for you.
While combing my hair now and wondering what dress to wear now, I say a little
prayer for you.
Oh yes, I do.
Forever,
ever, ever.
You stay in my heart, and I will love you forever,
ever,
ever.
Together,
forever,
together.
That's how it must be to live without you.
With
only me, heartbreak for me.
I run for the bus, dear. While riding, I think of us, dear.
Us, dear.
I say a little,
pray for you.
Hey. At work, I just take me some time. And all through my coffee break time,
break time,
I say a little,
pray
hey, hey, hey,
forever,
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 ever.
You stay in my heart, and I will love you forever,
forever,
and never,
ever.
We never will part. Oh, I love you together,
together, together.
That's how it must be to live without you. Could only mean heartbreak for me.
Nobody but me.
Ever,
ever.
You stay in my heart, and I will love you forever,
forever,
and never, forever. Oh, I love you together,
together, together.
That's how it must be to live without you. Could only mean heartbreak for you.
Hey, 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 hey. My darling, believe me.
Believe
for me,
me,
there is no one else but you. Dreams of me too. I'm in love with you.
Answer
my prayer now, baby.
Answer my prayer,
baby.
Answer my prayer,
hey.
Answer my prayer,
yeah.
Forever,
ever,
and
ever, ever.
You'll stay in my heart, and I will love you forever,
forever,
and ever.
Together,
we never will part. Oh, how I love you.
Forever, forever.
That's how it must be to live without you.
Would
only mean heartbreak for me.
Oh, my darling, believe me.
Believe me.
For me, there is no one else but you. Please love me too. I'm in love with you.
Listen, my friend.
Answer my prayer now, baby.
Answer my prayer,
baby.
Answer my
prayer,
baby. Answer my prayer,
baby.
Answer my prayer.
Answer my prayer now.
Answer my prayer,
baby.
Answer my prayer. Answer my prayer.
Having lived in New York as a Brooklynite all of this time and everything, with Stop and Frisk and everything, what are your general feelings about the way that the police sort of handle situation?
Well, for me, it's been very frustrating, primarily having grown up here in the 80s, you know, 70s and 80s, and have seen how there's really been no change in things. Everyone seems to be going about like there is, but, you know, we had several people die at the hands of the police in the 1980s. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, Michael Stewart was one that was chokehold, which outlawed the whole chokehold. So the chokehold within itself is supposed to be a practice that was eliminated from use by the police department. And to see it for me again, 20, 30 years later, I'm horrified.
What are you guys' general feelings on, first of all, stop and frisk being like okay here?
As a woman, I haven't heard any women getting stopped and frisked. I'd probably be terrified. I'd probably be talking shit. Excuse my French. My reaction would probably, I'd probably go in defense mode. But as a mother of a young male who's 22, I would fear for my son's life. Because they just pull you over. They just don't care.
So. Do you have something to add to that?
Absolutely. I have a son. And I fear for him every day. I call him, Clifton, how you doing? Are you okay? Because you just don't know. And I mean, he could just be walking down the street and some cop runs up to him thinking that he's somebody else. And you know, and my son, he would do like any other kid, hey, what's going on? And all of a sudden, that's resisting arrest.
As a black man, when I see a cop car approaching, I feel some sort of a way. I'm not like, oh, yay, the police. No. You know what I mean?
I remember as a kid playing cops and robbers and always wanted to be the cop. Wanting to be the cop was a great thing. That's what you wanted to do, because being a cop meant you were the hero. And there are cops out there, are heroes. And those are the ones that don't get the good rap that they're supposed to. They are.
Want to say this is not like a fuck the police show. at all. Police officers are human beings too, and they have stressful jobs, and they're putting their lives on the line every day, and that's relevant. So I don't want to get into having a cop bashing discussion necessarily. But what I'm not understanding, and I think maybe it's not even in the hands of the police officers for me, I don't understand, first of all, why you have to shoot to kill, even if a person is charging at you. Right. Even if you need to detain someone or get someone down, you don't have to murder them.
Exactly.
You can shoot a bitch in the kneecap. You can shoot them. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't understand.
You have a taser.
You have a taser, exactly.
So, I think.
Right.
It goes beyond defending oneself. Where is the humanity when a person tells you they can't breathe and you continue to choke them? Mm-hmm. Where is your sense of just human existence?
Right.
You have none.
I think the problem with our police officers, they need retraining for one thing, but they have gotten away with so much, and it's to the point where they feel that they can do anything and get away with it.
I met a very nice police officer in Atlanta once who told me that one of the worst parts of her job is that she feels like all of the bullies from high school and all of the kids that got picked on now want to be on the police force. And so you have to look at the personality and the mentality of these people. And then I just don't understand. Half these police officers are fat as hell. They can't run if something goes down. You're not in physical shape. Like, I don't understand how they pick the police officers. Did you have something to say?
Yeah, actually, my ex-boyfriend was trying to get into the police academy. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of amazing the amount of background checks they do actually do on these people. And that's what scares me the most is, I mean, he was waiting 2 years to hear back. And they wanted medical records. They wanted psychology records from when he was in second grade. Like, they want everything. And yet, you still have the people who want to actually help. And then you have the people who are power hungry. And it's how do you weed out people who are power hungry and get rid of them off the force.
The problem with stop and frisk and policies like that is that once you're accused of a crime, when you go to court, if you don't have the money to fight it, if you don't have time to take off from work, you plead guilty. So whether you're guilty or innocent, you're advised to plead guilty.
I think that we're moving towards a police state, and I believe that...
Oh, that's what happened.
That, yes, you know, black and brown people are the ones that are receiving and always have received the brunt of this. But I believe that that's starting to now expand.
That was my
now
point.
And I believe that if you pay attention and you look and see what's going on in the world, I mean, I read in the newspaper the other day, a college kid just got jumped. Did you guys see that?
I mean, he knocked the crap out of her.
Look at what they did to the journalists.
I'm scared of cops.
Look at what happened to the journalists that went to Ferguson. Mm-hmm. They were not on black and brown.
That's another thought, in Ferguson, if they were not afraid to do that to the media while the world is watching, then imagine what's happening.
Not for nothing, this shit was going on in Queens, too. Right. I was stopped and frisked at 15 because I was close to the more white-attended high school than the hood school where everybody was getting cut up, and I was grabbed, snatched up, and they thought I was 18, and you know, so they thought they were getting ready to bring me in.
Right.
And I was carrying a knife because I was in fear for my safety, and I didn't feel protected.
Like when I first moved to New York City, I had total trust in police. Like I would look around and see the police standing everywhere, and I would think to myself, I'm so glad that they are here protecting our city and they're doing their jobs. But now, hearing about all this other police brutality and stuff that's going on, like, when I see police, like, I sometimes think, are they a good cop or a bad cop? Like, I've lost that level of trust that I had because of stuff that happened.
I just want to continue. So, the police force, like you said, they react on instinct, whatever, but these kids were mainly all unarmed. They had no weapons on them.
Right.
They weren't coming at the police, like attacking them physically.
So my experience with the cops have not always been positive. From me seeing a dead body laying on the street and the cops driving past it telling me, have a happy Thanksgiving, to being pushed by the police officers, to, you know, there was corruption in the 77th precinct. So I was here for Abdel Louima. I was here for Abdul Diallo. So I know all of these, the instances that happened. You know, there was a police officer. When my son grew up, he wanted to be a cop, and it was something, my brother's a detective, but I was trying to talk my baby out of it. And there was a police officer on my block who worked for SVU. The precinct was literally next door to my building. And this cop would speak to me every day, hi, how are you? When am I gonna take you out? Whatever. He had a wedding ring, older white gentleman. And what really frightened me was being woken up out of my sleep, but the news was on, and seeing that this same police officer was arrested for soliciting sex from boys. So it wasn't that he maybe wanted to take me out. I think that he was trying to build my trust. To maybe get to my baby who wanted to be a police officer, who would have gone with him had he been an old enough age, because he knew that this was somebody mommy knew. And he's a cop, and the cop is a good guy. His uncle is a good guy. My problem with all of this is that we paint broad strokes with everybody. There are very good cops that I know, I'm friends with some of them. There are really bad cops that I've heard of, I know. So my perspective is a little bit different from, you know, other people, because I see the good, but the bad is so awful. And the bad can take our lives and take our loved ones away from us for absolutely no reason, just for bias. And I think that that's just horrible.
Hey, baby.
Hey.
Did you have your coffee? Did you breakfast?
Yeah, they know making the eggs on what?
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, Doug. Yeah. No, yeah, I can be there in 30 minutes. No. All right. See you soon.
Have a good day.
Yeah, I'm going to take care of you when I get back.
Hey, baby, come here. You forgot your sign.
You are a lifesaver.
Bye.
I'm a CEO at Microsoft and personal friends with Bill Gates. If you gun me down, it will be a PR nightmare.
Jamal?
Yes, Mom?
Don't forget your sign.
Okay.
Don't you okay me?
Yes, ma'am.
I said, don't you okay
me? Yes, ma'am.
Oprah awarded me a full scholarship and a special on OWN. If you gun me down, Viacom will destroy you. I'm Beyonce's hairstylist. I wish you would. I'm Donald Trump's illegitimate son. Gun me down and the Trump Towers will bury you alive! Don't shoot me! I'm a self-hating Republican. In the midst of the never-ending race war we are in, with police officers murdering unarmed males of color left and right with no consequence, we urge you, please wear your social standing signs, and if you can, keep a body camera recording device on you at all times. This has been a PSA from Damn, Can We Live?, a subsidiary of Screw Internalized and Institutionalized Racism.
About to say, the social media equally has been used for each one of these victims, including a video that wasn't one, and I can't even remember whether it was Ferguson or Brown, the Ferguson victim or the Staten Island victim. Mm-hmm. There was a video of that wasn't one of them that was let out. And of course, the first thing is, oh, he just robbed a store a few minutes before. Mm-hmm. And what everybody has to remember is he wasn't even accused of that crime yet. He wasn't under suspicion of that crime yet. And at this point, he will never be convicted of that crime.
Right.
So, but that video got out there, and there's always seems to be in these situations, social media is also used to try to find out. And trust me, you know, it's part of the spin doctor's job. Whoever the spin doctor is for the police force, there's PR people, the first thing they're going to do is go check on these victims. What can I find on them? I mean, and I'm a defense attorney, so, you know, we do that kind of stuff all the time.
They're bad everything. Mm-hmm. Everybody, every sect of life has a bad aspect to it. But I think it's the fact that when you get the police that are supposed to have this power, and then you get people that vote or don't vote for something, and then you get the media that spins things certain ways. I know, just as a white female, the media teaches me that black men are bad. And, you know, with the Ferguson thing right now, a lot of the stuff that I've heard is, oh, well, you know, he got shot because he was robbing a bank, and he's a 6'4", 200 and something pound black man. okay. But the media is telling me that means he is bad. And so,
more than that, he deserves to die.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which means that he's up to no good. He's clearly, like, not for the benefit of the rest of society.
And
breathing while black.
Yeah, and if everyone is, if all of these different aspects are coming together and none of them are really changing, they all...
That does lead into our next point. What's really interesting and disturbing for me is the way black victims are painted as if it's their fault somehow that they have been killed. And when you pair that with how actual white suspects and criminals are spoken about in the media, it's two totally different things. I remember seeing this particular headline about somebody that It wasn't the Colorado shooting, but somebody else had shot up a movie theater. And the headline was, shooter of theater was a social outcast, but a scientific genius. They called him a genius and a social outcast, you know, to justify his behavior.
Well, that's just the cell papers.
But Mike Brown, the day of his funeral, the New York Times, the Times, it wasn't even a podunk bullshit paper. The Times publishes an article saying Mike Brown was no angel. His last days were troubled. He had problems and promise on the day of his burial. And to make it even more offensive, they put an article about Darren Wilson next to it. And they're just like, he was bland and harmless and nobody saw this literally in the New York Times on opposite sleeves. When Trayvon died, it was all, he was rapping and what are you talking about? What are you talking about? How are you justifying any child being murdered?
I've been wondering, am I seeing an increase or is it just something the media has decided to pick up because it's a hot topic?
Yeah.
And if you want to, you know, whether you're selling physical papers or you're trying to get more hits on your site because of the advertisers you have there, I'm a bit of a conspiracy theorist, so a lot of times I think that...
And you're a lawyer.
And I'm a lawyer, right.
Do you think that since Trayvon, there has been a much bigger sort of scope on that? With it being, and you know, it does all boil down to business. Everyone was so... I don't think anything had been that racially dividing or that, like, you know, sort of a headline since OJ.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, there had been nothing that really divided, like, racist and made everybody be like, oh my gosh, what's going on since OJ? So that sold a lot of papers, and that got a lot of hits, and that got a lot of clicks, so
feels like that. I'm going to quote this person, and I'm probably never going to do this again, but I'm going to quote Taylor Swift, who said that we live in a takedown culture, and she's absolutely right.
Yeah.
We are taught to attack each other however means necessary to go ahead and get to where we need to be, and it's like, one thing leads to another thing and people just keep piling stuff on until it becomes this big old tower and then it just falls and everybody's screwed. That's the deal here.
Blame Fox News for a lot of it. Let's bring that up. That's like the elephant in the room, really, because it's a big freaking elephant. Pink, too. But and the reason why is because, I mean, you know, the coverage has gotten more and more blatantly racist.
Right.
I mean, so racist that even the few minorities that they have in that network is going, whoa, you're going too far. Whoa. You know, I mean, and because of that, because the rhetoric is getting much more racist and much more hateful and much more, it's sort of like driving this environment where people feel like they can get away with racist behavior, whereas like before it was still there, but we just didn't talk about it.
With me, I understand the whole thing that the media is making money from this and, like, you know, that's what they're gonna do, but I think the most important part is just seeing the younger people getting more involved and more aware of this, because when we had the Trayvon Martin situation, it was kind of like everybody was hyped, there was protests, people were involved, but then it's like after the verdict came out, everybody was mad, and then it just kind of like died. I mean, I'm 22, and most people on my Facebook timeline are like range from people that I knew in high school that could be like 18 and, like, you know, just younger people. And to see things change from, oh, I'm wearing this outfit today, I'm watching this now, to look at this, share this, I went to this rally, I feel like it's good because you haven't seen the youth that involved and that fired up in something. And yes, okay, we get it, like, you know, the people in the media are making money from it and it's seeming like a trend, but it's a trend that you should actually, like, care about. Like, it's a trend that's gonna raise awareness and that is getting people more involved in politics.
I'm gonna say really quickly that I think,
because a lot of white people are doing this, which is like, oh, well, you know, it's so yesterday, we shouldn't talk about it. Talking about it is increasing the racism. That is complete bull hockey. You know, I'm trying to keep it clean for TV. Anyway, but it is, because really it's like, I mean, however uncomfortable the conversation is, it has to be discussed. I mean, and that's the thing. It's like, okay, I'm a white person. I freely acknowledge white privilege exists.
there are only six companies that control 90% of the media. And when I say media, I mean TV outlets, yes. I mean news outlets, I mean newspapers, I mean movies, I mean everything. Right. Music.
From the producers of White Men Can Jump, That Is Only a Stereotype, comes the heart-wrenching documentary, Light-Skinned Girls, The Struggle.
Being light-skinned in this business, it's just really hard. This one time, I auditioned for something. And they gave it to a brown-skinned girl. What the fuck?
They would taunt me and say you're pretty for a light-skinned girl.
I had to tan to play Alfre Woodard's daughter.
I mean, like, I don't understand how I'm supposed to make it in this business when you got people like Jurnee Smollett and Raven Simone. I mean, they've been light-skinned in the biz since they were children. How the hell do I compete with that?
You know, being the poster child for Black Beauty is so hard. I can't even go sitting on the beach and expect a book. Every time Tyler Perry casts Angela Bassett, I just know I'm going to have to play the friend instead of a family member.
Every time people talk about the light-skinned privilege, they talk about Halle Berry. But when was the last time that bitch was relevant? When was she ever fucking relevant? She hasn't had a good movie since 2001. Look what I got to look up to.
People are always telling me I'm beautiful, but they don't even know me. I'm just tired of it.
Wooing, awing, ogling us. You know, I'm sick of the objectification. It's too much. It's too much.
Lupita, why?
They're always asking, what are they? Oh. I was so desperate. I went out for the Yiddish theater.
Reb Yid! Reb Yid! To Zikale!
God made me the universal image for my people. I mean, it's just so much pressure.
Light Skin Girls, The Struggle, produced by Donald Trump, Rachel Dolezal, and Tyler Perry.
I wanted to add to, while we're talking about media at this point of the conversation, and something that as an artist, as a musician, it weighs on me. I'm always thinking about what is it that I am saying? What is the message of what I am putting mm-hmm. out? And where is it coming from? Because yes, I have freedom of speech. Yes, I'm an adult. Yes, I can say whatever I want. But at the end of the day, if I am promoting myself to you, mm-hmm. if I'm asking you to check out my video or buy my song on iTunes or come to my show, I have to look at what I am giving you in exchange for your attention, in exchange for your patronage. And I think a major issue here is that, especially when you talk about children in New York and children that are from these areas, I feel like in a lot of ways, music and pop culture and the media is priming them to be targets.
Yes.
You are priming people to be targets. And then you want to attack them because they're sagging or they have on a cap or it looks like gang related. But at the end of the day, it's like, you know, and I'm not, I don't want to be like, it's her fault. I'm not pointing fingers, but I am saying, I don't understand how you as an artist, half of these hip hop artists are not from the streets. They are not from the ghetto. They are college educated. They have studied marketing and branding and know exactly what they're doing. And so you're perpetuating messages that that is the young people's Bible. Pop culture is what raises us. Mm-hmm. Television and media is what raises, you can say whatever you want, but that is our biggest influence. And so I feel like for anybody to be out here like, yes, do this, do that, do the third, knowing that that could have not only negative but fatal repercussions for the person out there actually doing it while you're on tour collecting a dollar is a problem.
Mm-hmm. But a lot of people are doing these things, but I feel like there's still kind of a double standard. Like, I get it, people have to do better, but I really do feel like, honestly, people have to raise their children better also.
Yeah, I agree.
And then I also feel that I get that that is the garbage that's being put out. But also, is that still the reason that you should kill somebody? And I feel like that's what it comes, that's what it keeps, I'm not saying that, I know that's not what you're saying, but a lot of the people on the media keep saying, well, because they listen to this music, because they're buying this music and they're getting into these trends, that therefore they're responsible, as you're saying, for their own death. And that's why I get, it's like, we could spin this in a circle every day. It's like, you don't know what that kid listens to at the end of the day. You don't know, like, why they dress this way or what they can afford, but you sitting here being like, oh, they're trying to be like this rapper. Oh, they want to be hard because they saw this on this TV show. Oh, that's why I should kill them. That's a different thing. You know what I'm saying?
It's just as people in general, there's nobody, like, there's nothing out there that kids can look at and say, this is a good example of something that I want.
There is, there is.
Wait, 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 wait,
wait, wait, wait, wait, wait, wait, wait, wait,
wait,
wait,
wait, wait, wait, wait, wait,
wait, wait,
I totally agree with you, Shuri. I think what we are saying is, instead of shifting that narrative to the children, shift that narrative to the artist. The question is, are artists and is the media taking responsibility for their role and the messages that
they're not? What pisses me off,
say something.
A lot of them are out here doing this freaking ice bucket challenge, but none of them have said anything about Ferguson, and that pisses me off the most. It's like, you have enough time to play and do this ice bucket challenge and say this is for a good cause. Yeah, support that, donate to that all you want to, but you don't want to say anything about your own people getting killed or about that. Like,
they are, because at the end of the day, and you know, we do a lot of monitoring of what the kids listen to, even at this age, and my husband's a former hip-hop artist. There's things of my husband's music I do not let my kids listen. We know, oh, no, you can't listen to that one. There's one song I'm singing from a show, and I'd say something. I'm like, oh, no, you can't. Oh, mommy, that's you singing? Nah, you can't listen to that.
Right.
So, I mean, at the end of the day, these children who at some point when they're doing this, they're not doing it with their own money. And so, you know, as the part of me as an artist, yes, I have a responsibility to be responsible, but what's going on with the parents and us as people? Somehow they're becoming millionaires, billionaires with money that we're spending.
So all of this is bigger than just us as parents. And it becomes a part of the culture. Mm-hmm. Music is culture. Your arts is our culture. And our kids, no matter what we do, they're going to want to be involved in something that gives them, that's bigger than them.
What's
up, y'all? It's your girl, Bimby Anal Beads. Yeah, a.k.a. the mistress of a rap, a.k.a. the Remy-headed brat dog. Chill. We're here to talk about my new album. Sucking that dick while the coke on the table. Betraying these niggas just like Cain did Abel. See bitches be stunting fairy tales and fables. They wanna be Bambi, but baby, you just ain't able. Yeah. My first female empowerment song was a song called Twerk That Ass and Get His Money. Cause you know, I just wanted all my ladies to know that you got the power to shake that ass if you want to. Okay, but don't do it for him. Okay, do it for you. And while you out there doing it for you, get his money! I also wrote my song, it was really, you know, to embrace Black heritage, you know, for strong Black women to really empower them. It's called Put On That Blonde Wig, Them Green Contacts, and Shake That Big Fat Pussycat. Yeah. You know, I just wanted them to know that if you want to change your entire appearance to look more European, yet still exploit the most African parts of your body, it's okay. You can do that. All right. Yeah. I also wrote the rap anthem, Skip School, Suck Dick, So You Can Get McDonald's After School. And I did this for two reasons. One, to educate young girls. And two, to promote healthy eating. I mean, you can go to school every day. Listen, for the most part, it's okay if you pleasure a nice gentleman who can buy you food on the way home before you do your homework. And last, but certainly not least, my hit. I'm rich and famous and I still fuck drug dealers because I got a fat ass. I mean, I wanted to inspire the young men to become entrepreneurs and, you know, so they can get a rich, bad bitch like me. Yeah. Skip school, suck dick, then Mickey D's. If he had you on your knees, then cold a pounder with cheese. Oh! Yeah, get money. Yeah, yeah.
So, Bambi, I can't help but see that it seems like you target young people and children a lot in your music. So I'm wondering, do you feel responsible for like the increase in teen abortions, kids getting shot, selling drugs? Do you at all feel like you have anything to do with that, with your influence?
Yo, so clearly I'm not out here destroying communities or killing people's minds with my music. Yo, I ain't get into this game for the kids. And yeah, I know, okay, my fun is the same as the Bratz dolls. And I name myself after a famous cartoon character that's forever engraved in the minds of the young people. But for real, it's not like that. Okay, and it's not my fault. It's not my fault that you need to raise your kids, okay? And yeah, maybe I could do it easier or I see them more, because while you at work, I'm everywhere. But for real, I'm socially responsible. It is not my fault. I am not responsible for the degradation of the human mind. All right, I don't do this for y'all. Even though I couldn't do it without y'all. Come on, y'all, go cop the CD.
What's the album called?
Oh, fuck you and your kids, I don't give a shit. Get money on iTunes now. Yeah.
Thank you.
And it also made me think of the reactions of, oh, you feel safe, for a lot of us in urban areas, and I think this crosses a lot of color boundaries too. They've done tests where, especially people of color, when you see an officer, your heart rate, even if you're, everything's legal, your car is fine, your registration's up to date, and I know I particularly feel nervous in my car all the time. The heart rate goes up. Yesterday, we're driving, my 7-year-old said, and I just remember this, he said, oh, there's a police officer there. As if to tell me, like, oh, you know, because he's heard me so much worry about the police that I've already started to mold him to warn me when he sees a cop. And I said, wow. Like, and I don't want to do that either. So now I'm thinking, how do I make him understand that there are good cops and bad cops, but at the same time, he's going to be a young black man someday, and I need him to be careful.
I wanted to read this to you guys. This is just a bit of a history of how the police force came about in America. So I said earlier that slavery began in 1619. 11 years later, the first known American law enforcement brigade was formed in Boston in 1630, and it was just called the Watch. In these days, communities simply appointed people to look out for each other. This then gave way to civilians being assigned law enforcement duties with no pay. But the actual policing system that we know today began in America around the year 1833 in Philly, only 32 years before slaves were emancipated. Philly was the first to organize a 24-hour police force. Boston followed in 1838. New York City followed in 1845, 20 years before freed were enslaved. I bring this up to illustrate that the beginning of police force in this country was formed during slave times, when black people by constitution were not even considered human. So that raises another question is, how do you then turn something that was never really created for the betterment of you into something that ever makes you feel safe? I want to read this quote from a book that I read. The birth and development of the American police can be traced to a multitude of historical, legal, and political economic conditions. The institution of slavery and the control of minorities, however, were two of the more formidable historical features of American society shaping early policing. Slave patrols and night watches, which later became modern police departments, were both designed to control the behaviors of minorities. Many Southern police departments began as slave patrols in the first place. So when we're having this conversation, we have to look at the history of our country, which is hard to do because it's painful and it's ugly. And we sit up here united as all different races, but this is our home. And as much as it sucks to look back there, you kind of have to really, really get to the grit of it. This situation was never designed to make black people feel safe, ever. It was not in its origin created for that. And that's a large part of, I think, a part of the issues that we're discussing today. The mistrust, you know, the fact that, you know, all of these miscommunications, the brutality, I think it all kind of stems from this directly.
Okay. I think if any of us can relate to this scenario, I think if any of us go to the doctor with an ailment, the first thing the doctor wants to take is a medical history. Racism is in the DNA of America. Amen. This country was founded on exploitation. Fleeing exploitation and then coming here to begin to exploit others. And the economic system of this country has from day one been sustained through methods of exploitation. And I think that in order for us to deal with the issue, we need to begin to have some real honest conversations about that. About the DNA of this country, about where we come from and what our overall thinking is. Because you asked the question, do we feel safe with the police? My answer, no. When I see the police, my heart starts racing, I feel fearful, and I feel like if they come near me, I'm afraid. And that's not because of the media, that's because of my own experience as a black woman in America. Being pulled over for no reason in urban and suburban areas. Urban areas, well, your car matches a certain description. Suburban areas, whose car is this? Why do you have a car like this? So, you know, and I think that the media and so many of us buy into all the sideline distractions that are put up to be a smokescreen against us having honest conversations about what happened, where they're looting, well, black folks need to learn how to act. That's not the problem. The problem is that our society has this economic system built upon exploitation. Corporations get paid for exploitations. The number of jail cells are determined to be built based on third and fourth grade test scores. In many of the states in this country, you know, privatization of the prison system, mass incarceration, you know, all of these things are generating real money. And the masterminds behind it, behind the corporate greed, is they get us to see each other as a problem. You know, they have convinced white people that black folks are the problem. And, you know, the Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. If we love something inordinately, we will naturally develop a fear that we will lose that thing we love. So if we have an ungodly love of money, we believe that we need to protect our economic status against this immigrant and against that gay person and against this person of color, because ultimately they are here to displace me. They are here to do to me what our ancestors did to them. Yep. Mm. We are in no way in a post-racial economy.
Absolutely. Give it up for Bonnie, everyone.
Wait into my life. Oh. Concrete jungle, there's a hunger for justice that makes my core rumble. Try to stay humble as all my fit crumbles. They got us outnumbered while they got all our hands up. Pick your position, hunter to hunter. Control is no more, we're going to war. Make a choice, what will you live or die for? Makes me wanna holler, this racism and squalor. Fight for today, cause there may not be tomorrow.
Yes, honey.